generally understood using a set of fruits in cross section, particularly the citrus fruits, but here and there other fruits also. Now you see, that may be the case for glands, but for glands like the salivary glands, the pancreas, etc., where there is a very prominent duct and branching pattern, this picture of the grapes may probably be equally interesting to understand. And when we talk of the lobulation pattern of the lobules or the internal architecture of the glands, I'm sure this butter paper and its partition may be a good way of understanding. And if I tell you the biscuits and chocolate are inside, it makes the lobules even more interesting to taste. Now, this is a cut piece of watermelon, maybe one of the best examples to understand the pyramidal architecture of cell, that is. Next, lymph node. Slowly, I'm going to reduce the number of comparisons and more into more serious discussions. That's where this lymph node is a transition slide. You can see, among the commonly missed item in a light microscopy, in a routine H&E, in a routine class, is this particular structure in the deep cortex. It is called high endothelial venule. When I check this item in the literature, it has got certain amount of selective permeability to certain cell types. Hence, it has a lot of clinical significance. Next, palatine tonsil. I would like to caution all my students are hearing me that this is probably the one epithelium, probably the one structure where the same epithelium is seen in two avatars. One is the normal epithelium, just like anywhere else in the mouth cavity, stratified squamous, non-keratinized epithelium. As I said, this is also the epithelium where it's a very interesting variant, namely the reticulated epithelium is also visible. The difference between the normal epithelium and the reticulated epithelium is, reticulated epithelium is a worn out or a moth-eaten appearance. Only thing is there are no moths there. The local macrophages, the local lymphocytes, the local neutrophils, they burrow into the epithelium. See, this is one thing that you should remember. Very close to the germinal center and that nodule, primary nodule that you see, the activity of these cells are so high that they cut across and they burrow into the epithelium, rendering it reticulated. This is one very interesting slide where the contrast is extremely beautiful. Next, spleen. There are certain interesting things in the spleen, but routinely missed in H&D. But I have used a special stain. Even after using a special stain, I had to search for this particular, I would say, field for about 2 hours to get the photograph. Watch this. You see, routinely we talk about, you know, stave cells, and we say, you know, ultra microscopic view, and it may not be routinely visible. But I have used, I think if I'm right, Catechu stain. Yes, this is Catechu stain. And with a lot of difficulty, with the highest possible resolution, without losing clarity, I was able to identify one small area, a blood vessel, a venous, a sinusoid. Now, we know that there is a high level of permeability in this area, but we also know there are flat, long running, that is longitudinally running, endothelial cells which are unique to this region, and we have always called it as stave cells. Now you can actually see the stave cells in this particular photograph. You see, that's the example. I have given a wine barrel to give you a comparison with the stave cells. Thymus, again cautioning you and redrawing the attention of the students to another very interesting slide. Now, most of the in most of my lectures I present the Hassall's corpuscles as some kind of a cyclonic storm. Okay, that's good enough. But then there are beyond the Hassall's corpuscles. See, we talk about epithelial reticular cells, etc. But there are very specific cells that can be identified around the Hassall's corpuscles. Now, here is one example. I have highlighted that in a bigger circle there. That's one type of epithelial reticular cells. That is yet another epithelial reticular cells. Now, please be warned. I learned it from my own experience. Hassall's corpuscles is virtually a signature identifying feature. I repeat, Hassall's corpuscles is a signature identifying feature of thymus. But I curiosity drove me that here and there, not every slide, here and there, particularly tonsil, I did find something similar to Hassall's corpuscles. Now, that triggered an unusual drive of curiosity, and I tried to check the literature. Corpuscular type structures are known to occur in virtually every other lymphoid tissue. Only thing is, we don't call it Hassall's corpuscles because the organization is not as epithelioid and as typical as in a thymus. Therefore, if in your career, in either in anatomy or in your future, if you occasionally see Hassall's corpuscle like structure in any other lymphoid organ, best ignore it because this is possible. The reason books give is, since the process of the immunological response is more or less similar, this pattern may be possible. Although we still have a controversial understanding of the origin of these thymic corpuscles. Therefore, as far as your exams are concerned, thymic Hassall's corpuscles are unique and unique only to the thymus and nothing else. But however, if you want to learn for the joy of learning, yes, it could be there in other structures also. Next, pancreas. Over the presentation, you will see a lot of flowers popping up because the way the acini look or the way the cell look is also similarly how the petals of some flowers also look. So I was able to get this as a comparison to understand. Next, here is a very unusual thing. Generally, we talk of centrosinar cells, and most of the slides which are reasonably stained, particularly the ones that are poorly stained, will give you a clear picture of the centrosinar cell. However, I have seen that excess staining is counterproductive to our recognition of centrosinar cell. But if you want to understand what is a centrosinar cell, it is a cell inside the acinus. That means it is a small group of cells which are pushed into the acinus. To explain this, I got this unusual photograph of a peeled orange. Other than the cluster of orange pieces outside, there is a small cluster on the inside. I thought, although this is a very unusual finding in this fruit, it is good enough to be used as a comparison for our understanding of centrosinar cells. Now, this is yet another demo of the centrosinar cells, but the only point is the staining is different. It is a catechu stain. Catechu stains are single contrast stains which give excellent dark brown, yellow, ivory yellow contrast. We have conventionally told our students time and again, batch after batch, that in routine HND preparations, alpha, beta, delta cells, etc. cannot be identified. However, there are book preferences to say that alpha cells are zonated in some areas, beta cells are, okay, we can agree on that, but that is only inferential. But we have special stains. I was fortunate that I had this stain in my department. For students, it may not matter what stain it is. Suffice to say, it is a one stain. It's a modification of the routine hematoxylin stain, which gives you an excellent contrast between alpha cell and a beta cell. That's all, alpha and a beta cell. See, that's a beta cell. And the previous one was a alpha cell. I repeat, alpha, beta, alpha, beta. Next. We'll skip that. I have already talked about the centrosome in our cells. Testis. I'm sure routine my light microscopy, we are always confident, and students close to going to the exam, I'm sure you will all identify primary, secondary spermatogonia. And some of the luckier ones may have identified the Sertoli cell. Now, for those students who have not been able to identify the Sertoli cell, I will show you some of the finest designs of Sertoli cells, because I was able to get one such slide which has excellent contrast staining, and incidentally it is HND. Now you see, these are the seminiferous tubules, and I have highlighted one or two Sertoli cells. Now that square, it is still not very clear, but I just told you that there is something interesting there. How exactly is the detail? You will notice now. You see, unlike the spermatogonia, spermatocytes, etc., this is a long pillar-like cell. Runs from the basement membrane up to the lumen as a long single cell. You can see here, I have marked in a rectangle. That is a beautiful, beautiful demo of a Sertoli cell. Yet another Sertoli cell. There are plenty. I mean, if you have a good slide, virtually every seminiferous tubule, you can identify about 10 or 15 Sertoli cells. Next, this is the point where you must remember, adjacent Sertoli cells are plastered to each other by tight junctions, and that is supposed to be the blood testis barrier. Next, stomach. Most often, either because of tension or slide quality is poor, whatever be the reason, we're not going to that. Many a times during the exam, either in spotters or in histo discussion, I notice students having a dilemma, which is duodenum, which is stomach. I have not had a problem identifying, because I use a simple technique to identify one from the other, because a projecting villus viewed in another context can also be compared with a equid, which is going down into the surface. Now, watch carefully what I'm saying. When you have these two slides, identify an area something like this in your slides. Identify something similar to these. On the duodenum, I have identified cross sections of the villi, and in the stomach, I have identified the cross section of the pits immediately below the surface. Now, I will double check these for greater detail and compare only two items. One is the lumen. In the case of the duodenum, watch carefully. The lumen is outside the villus. I repeat, the lumen is outside the villus. But in the case of the gastric pit, the lumen is inside the pit. That means in a cross section of the pit, the lumen will be the innermost. Around that will be the columnar cells, then the basement membrane, then the lamina propria. But in the case of duodenum, it's the other way around. Lamina propria will be the innermost, then the basement membrane, then the tall columnar cells, and finally the lumen. So there is a reverse contrast in the way the structures are layered. Same thing I told you just now, lamina propria. Now you see,